How to Disrupt a Competitive Market, Part 2, with White Claw.
Let's get into it. What's up, everyone? Sean Azari here with Matt SKOPAK.
What's up, guys?
Welcome to Deep Dive Episode 8, where we take businesses like White Claw, where we deep dive into the marketing and business strategies such that you can take away and then implement them into your business. And, you know, there's a few things I want to like about White Claw, and there's a few things that I don't in terms of implementing strategy. White Claw actually emerged from an existing brand, I would say, called Mike Hard's Lemonade, which existed for quite some time. White Claw started about, 3 years ago?
Yeah, 2016 it was started, but didn't really take off till 2019?
I believe so, last year. And obviously White Claw is, if you guys are not familiar with it, this is it. It is basically a beer or with, we'll say white seltzer. Hard seltzer with some alcohol, 5% alcohol. If obviously you know, being in the alcohol industry, it is tough. It is competitive. It is really hard to stand out, but these guys, obviously with their experience with their previous beverage, they really were able to disrupt it. Doesn't matter even if he had leverage or not, it is good to understand some of his marketing tactics, and that's what we're gonna get into right now.
Yes.
Why don't you start with number one, SKOPAK.
So number one, guys, identifying new trends and creating a product that aligns with it. So this is something that they did very well. When I say they, it's called Mark Anthony Brands. The founder founded numerous alcohol brands, but I think, like we said, Mike's Hard Lemonade. His name was Anthony Von Mondi, I believe, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. So he came up with this concept. First, he created Mike's Hard Lemonade, and now he came up with White Claw. And what he saw in the trend that has been going on probably for the last 5 to 10 years is a health trend that millennials are definitely taking part in and driving to a huge extent. We see it with Quest Nutrition. We're seeing it now with LaCroix earlier, another just regular seltzer. And he saw this trend and he basically pivoted, I guess, Mike's Hard Lemonade. And
so Mike's Hard Lemonade had tons of sugar,
tons of sugar,
which is not being health conscious. It's not really, with today's market, everybody wants to be healthy, like you're saying.
Exactly.
People want convenience, which is another thing it does solve.
Exactly. So White Claw's, I think, main points for their proposition for customers was healthy, 100 calories, low sugar, low carbs, keto, aligns with so many different diets. And it's convenient. You don't need multiple mixers. You don't need alcohol, different types of alcohol. It's everything you need in a can, barbecues, summertime, fun, football. And he basically played on that trend, which was a huge success. And that is basically one thing as a business owner, what you need to do if you see a trend coming out, if you see a emerging trend, whether in your business or in general that you can create a product to, see trend, identify, then create a product that would take advantage of that trend.
So really understanding trends and where the market is going is very, very important. Really, it's like, for instance, if you have a current product, right, that you already have, so you don't want to reinvent something, see how your product could actually fit that trend, or if it's actually, it's aligning to what you're going to see in the next 5 years. SKOPAK, is there, I know there's ways, but—
So like Sweetberry, what we've done is, keto diets are basically all the rage for the last 2 to 3 years. So we basically
Sweetberry's the fast casual restaurant.
Acai bowls, smoothies, wraps, salads, poke. So we saw a huge trend of a keto low carb diet. So we've looked into and we're working on and almost there creating basically a keto acai bowl that is very low in sugar and carbs, but high in fat using like coconut milk and things like that, chia seeds. But basically taking advantage of that trend that we're seeing and creating a product that we currently have the ingredients for and then marketing it towards that trend. So that's an example of how we do. And basically that's what you need to do for your business. Always think outside the box, try to identify trends that you're going to think are going to be successful and then market to that trend.
Awesome. Number two, keep or write your ads based on the current climate, the current environment. You know, your ads need to be relevant such that it hits home and it converts better. White Claw, what White Claw is doing, and as of today's June 8th, correct?
Correct.
June 8th, we're still at, you know, COVID scenario where, you know, we're, a lot of us are staying home. Well, you know, we're another phase, but I don't want to get into that. But their ads say, I believe it says, enjoy White Claw at home. Get White Claw delivered at home, right? A lot of their ads are based on that because what? People are at home and they still want to sell. They want to convert. And actually, the alcohol business, right, has been booming. So now how can you take that idea? See, people sell, you know, I know Fashion Nova, for instance, right? They actually create a whole product line based on being comfortable at home. And then they converted their ad, or they readjusted their ad or pivoted their ads based on that environment, or based on that based on their copy and so forth. So relevancy is huge when marketing. You know, you got to update not only your ads, your website, your email campaigns and so forth. So if you want to hit home, if you want to convert better, if you want high open rates, make sure you are understanding the relevant market, the relevant, the current climate, such that you can actually identify with the consumer.
And it could be seasonality. I know White Claw does a great, they do in the summers, they focus really, I bet you even if you watch their advertising the next month or two, they will have ads about backyard barbecues and things like that, or pools and backyard pools, because they, that's basically where we're going with this summer. However, during football season, they advertise not watching men watching football at the bar, they advertise men and women playing flag football in the football season. So they do a very good job of seasonality. Can't even drink. Of seasonality. And that's something very good. And how could you basically do that as your brand? Just think, be creative in terms of either seasonality, or there's just so many different ways.
Yeah. Think sports. Think, again, current environment, trend. Like you said, trends before. Yeah. That is huge. So why don't you move into number three?
Number three, design your product with your targeted demographic in mind. So this is something that White Claw, I think, did. That is why they are so successful. That's why we're hearing their supply chain, basically they can't keep up, is they created a product that is very,
well, it's very general neutral, gender, very minimalistic. Neutral,
minimalistic.
People want to see that. Like, I would mind after I'm done with it, well, not done with it, but a full can, one on my on my shelf as like a backdrop or as a decorative, because their cans are so nice. People want, you have to create stuff that actually.
So you have to know who your target market is, and that's one thing. I think they knew that they were attacking the whole healthy alcohol sector or segment, the market they created. So they made very minimalistic, right?
Minimalistic,
correct,
type of design.
White, just a touch of coloring, just kind of, if you think about it, just like their drink. It's basically a hard seltzer with a touch of flavoring. So, and it appeals to everyone. It's not pink. It's not very manly. And what that did is that basically they were able to take in the whole market, men and women. So their customer base for alcohol is huge. But as a business owner, what you have to do is you have to understand who your target customer is, and you have to make sure your packaging aligns to that target customer. So if you are a women's company, your design and packaging should not be very manly, or should be more subtle, white, pinks and things like that, light purples. If you're a beer company, this is kind of where beer companies were struggling with. They market and they're very heavily towards men.
Like, so Modelo, for instance. Like a Modelo. Exactly, you don't see it's the way it's designed, the way you could see it's more targeted for males.
Exactly. So what did White Claw do? They created something that looks appealing to both, and that overtook the market and basically segmented and captured sales from both demographics.
I like it. All right. That actually goes off with number four. It's a very similar thing that aligns with number three. Have your products designed around social media. You want something to be Instagrammable. You want your products to do the marketing itself. That's so important. I say this to clients all the time. Like, you really want, when someone gets your product, you want them to actually share the product on their feed, right? Across their 500,000 or I don't know, X amount of followers. That's more exposure, free exposure, right? If you don't have products right now designed around social media, you need to pivot. There's so many, I'm telling you, SkOPAK. Yeah. There is a lot of companies I've worked with. They're so like, almost like, I don't know how to say it, stubborn almost. Like, no, this is the way it mine's designed. I'm like, okay, fine. You want to keep your design like that? That's not, no problem. But you better be ready to spend a lot of money on PR, on everything yeah. to get your product out there, rather than spending less, which I'm always, you know, especially if you're a small business owner or you just, you know, you're trying to raise money in here and there, if you're working with your own money, especially, you really want your own money, your that $1 to go really far, that yeah. $10 to go
marketing
really far.
Marketing is expensive.
Marketing is really expensive. So have your products designed around social media. What I do with Reborn, as you can see, a lot of my canvases are Instagrammable. The one behind me, as you can see, Sugar and Kush, which SkoPak is very involved in, right? A CBD company. Product pops. People want to put yeah. that outside. Like I have it right in my, you can't see it. It's on my shelf back there. I want it there because it looks cool. It looks yeah. nice. I mean, it's a little feminine.
It's not only in your packaging too, though. We discussed this in restaurants, bars. You need to have Instagrammable decor or neon signs, restaurants, decor, picture areas.
So you'll for see instance,
every, we're right if, near New York City.
If you own a restaurant, right, you could either have food that's in scramble, and if you can't do that, make sure your decor is. Yeah. Change up your decor, create neon signs.
Yeah, we do that with Sweetberry, the fast casual.
Yeah,
we every do. Store we have a
like a slogan.
A slogan that appeals to millennials that basically attracts and uses photo ops.
Sometimes you may, I mean, depending, again, you gotta know your demographic, which is very important, who's yes. gonna walk in, who's gonna walk out to actually take that picture.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you gotta be very controversial. You gotta say like, you want to curse, like, what did you say before? You know, get laid here. Like a neon sign.
Yeah.
You
can at a get, bar. If you know customer base is usually young at bars, if you're going into New York City or depending where, get laid here, something like that. Is it appropriate in all places? Absolutely not.
Controversy always wins. People can relate yeah. that. People will share that picture and then tag the location, which is your venue, if you yeah. own a restaurant, bar, whatever it is. Another of my clients, just want to bring it up real quick, SoJo Spa Club. They're a Korean spa, about 150,000 square foot.
Gorgeous.
Every amenity is Instagrammable. People are going there just to take a picture. Yeah. At the end of the day, people want to take a picture of what they could resonate with, what looks nice and cool, right? Or on top of that, it is, I forgot what was the other one. It is based on, experience. Did I say experience?
Yes. Think you have yet.
Yeah, experience. People want to take pictures, videos on experience. So
and that's what this was.
All
this
of this driven. Is, this is not only experience, but they're this is a beautiful packaging. The way they're marketing, they're making it look cool. They have, I mean, we're not gonna get into it, but this is like just slight things they've done. They've worked with influencers where they've gone viral. They've encouraged their fans to actually generate, create memes such that it does the marketing itself. I have a fly around
the
me.
Windows are open yeah. tonight. Tonight.
So again, so just to highlight, or give a little summary yep. headline is basically make your products designed around social media, make them Instagrammable.
Yeah.
So
I love that idea. Yeah. It's the biggest thing. And I think when looking back at all the podcasts, this is number 8, why all these companies that we have looked into have been able to grow as quickly as they have is the use of social media, maybe not by design, but they create great looking packaging. They targeted millennials, and basically by what the cause of that is they went viral. They yep. had a huge social media presence or that type of exposure, and they were able to knock it out of the park. And this is the theme over and over and over again that we're seeing with every one of these companies is that they have to leverage usually millennials, great packaging, and that in turn just makes the company successful. So I think
do you have a number 5 or is my should
no, I do okay? I think you have a number 5.
You're I got a number 5.
Jump in.
Which is always test multiple designs, especially when you're running ads and even sometimes on your website you could do A/B testing. I believe there's a website called crazyegg.com which allows you to do that. There's probably other websites that allow you as well, but let's talk about ads in general. What White Claw does is you'll see is they'll have the same ad with different thumbnails. Also, they have the same ad with different copies so that you could create a campaign on Facebook, let's say it's a prospecting campaign, right? With different, across an ad set. An ad set could be like a certain audience type, right? Within that ad set, I don't wanna get too technical, but I am a little bit. Within that ad set, you could have multiple ads. Now your ads could be one creative with 3 different copies, like the caption that goes with it, right? Facebook and Instagram is gonna determine based on the results which one it's going to allocate most of its spend to. That's when you have actually this campaign budget optimization. Again, I don't want to get into too detail. You guys can Google this, what CBO campaign budget optimization is, but high level, it basically says if you have that on, Facebook will decide which one of those ads converts better. So that's all these A-B testing that you want to do. Other ways you could do it, you could have the same copy across different creatives. That's very important.
Yeah.
Again, this is all A-B testing. You want to do that. Facebook allows you to do that, right? And it will decide for you which one converts better based on the results. So don't be lazy. Freaking create a lot of ads, create a lot of creatives such that you can make sure that you're actually converting in sales with low customer acquisition costs.
And correct me if I'm wrong here, but make sure also, I mean, know what you're creating too in terms of White Claw is not really driving sales. Some of their ads are probably educating people. So as a business, you have to have ads that are both trying to drive sales, but you have to have other ones probably that are educating people on your product, who your brand is, and things like that.
Yeah.
And that's something that White Claw does a very good job of.
Wait, what does a good job of what?
Of educating their consumer about their product.
Nah, I don't think so, actually.
I think so. Look at their website. Their website literally educates you with the description and as soon as you get there.
Okay, so that part I do is actually, even before we end this podcast, one of the things I actually don't like what they're doing, but they can do it because they could afford it, is their at least their Instagram. I didn't really look. I looked at other things too, but I noticed their Instagram is very product centric. Now, if you notice, if you listen to the other podcasts or the videos, I've stated a lot, especially if you're working on a budget, you need to not only experiences, but you can't just showcase your product. However, you could showcase how your product's being used. That's important. Like if I was, you know, just one type of strategy, if I would create more recipes, they're doing a little bit and they're actually not, I mean, optimizing it because the way they have their recipes, their videos were showcasing recipes. They're in the 16.
It's hard to create recipes though. How are you going to create recipes with a White Claw?
You can.
I don't know.
You get a special. You get someone's experience.
Me and Sean always don't agree. Yeah. And I want you to think that we always agree. We usually, a lot of time, we do not. Creative. I'm more statistical, financial background. So we do crash heads. It's hard, but there are ways to do it.
But what's going to get more engagement? What's going to get more engagement is by sharing people what people can do with it.
Maybe like experiences. I think experiences is the way.
So another thing is, well, one thing people could learn from, especially with Red Bull, right? You don't see anything about their product. What do you see? Extreme sports. Because what does that relate to? Extremity, right? Like
caffeine, excitement,
high energy, all that, which is great. You don't ever see the product. However, in the back end, I believe I got to check the Red Bull ads, right? They could be advertising their product, but what they're doing is putting out content that people are like, whoa, energy, and are just like athletes, whatever. They're all going extreme stuff, extreme sports, right? They're getting that audience, and a much easier way of acquiring.
They just have to be careful though, because I think look at their packaging. It has a wave on it. They really correlate themselves with summer, which is it's great. I mean, they're the drink of the summer, but you have to be very open then and get more seasonality too.
So they could like just football they could change season. That next day with a snowman.
That's a brand though. You can't just change a branding.
Can.
Oh, see? This is us. This is the constant theme. But overall, I mean, to do what they did in the amount of time that they did it from 2019, like starting 2016, but they own about 70% of the market share in the hard seltzer. It's a $1 billion industry. It's crazy. And all the things that we talked about definitely helped get them to where they are now.
I love it. I think that's it, right?
That's all.
Guys, I hope you liked this episode. This was episode 8. If you did, give us a 5-star rating on the podcast. If you're watching this via video, hit the thumbs up button. If you have comments, you have anything you want to ask, please leave it in the comments section below. You have your Instagram now, Matthew.
Matthew_Alexander with 2 X's.
Alexander, but if you want to tweet him, I think tweeting is better for questions purposes. Cool. You want to ask we'll put the handle on the thing, but right say it right there. Yep, say
it's it. SKOPAK.
SKOPAK. I'm @Sean_Azari. But I'm always, you know, listening to you guys in the comments as well. So see you guys next week. We got a lot up our sleeves. We're going to be doing this on Mondays now. We'll see you soon, right?
All right.
Peace.
Bye.